when I was talking to the Prime Minister and the President in the room there, we decided, the three of us, that I could go on making conversation with them for hours and hours, but that's not the name of the game. The name of the game is to open it up the floor and let the floor ask questions. Because we've got two great gentlemen in front of us, or two great leaders. As you heard, the President Frederick de Klerk, what he did in South Africa. And beside me on my left side, I am convinced as a Hungarian that the future of Hungary is in the hands of the Prime Minister, who is doing a fantastic job in transforming the 40 years of ruthless communism into a country that will stand its place in Europe as it did before. So I don't know if the two of you have some comments about the two speeches.
I don't have any particular comment at the moment. As a non-European, as an African, viewing Europe from afar, what is bothering me is it appears to me quite often as if Europe has become a hybrid between a federal state and a confederal union. A hybrid cannot succeed. I don't see federalization of Europe as an achievable goal. There are too many smaller nations who would not like to be governed from afar. Therefore, I think the concept of also, while dealing with the economic crisis, the concept of also giving attention anew about possible restructuring of where Europe is now, to undo the hybrid status, if I can put it that way, can be conducive towards a more successful Europe.
Prime Minister.
I'm not a brave man as the President, but I agree.
So, here we have two sectors in this, and divided up into six. I'd like to open up the questions to the floor. We've got a half an hour to discuss the fate, or the past and the fate of South Africa, and we've got the half an hour to discuss Hungary and what the Prime Minister is doing in Hungary. So I will first open up the floor to discussions in the four parts. So please, hands up, and it would be very nice if you could stand up when you speak, so that people can see you and that you can at least give your name and direct your questions to the two panelists, please. So hands up, please. The first question is always difficult.
Right.
Oh, there. Could you stand up, please?
Sure. My question is for President de Klerk. President de Klerk, you mentioned that the financial system is one of the global forces that we need to watch. And you also mentioned that one of the key green lights for you to move forward, ending apartheid, was the end of international communism. I also wanted to ask, what influence did the international financial sanctions have in the timing, or how did that impact your decision in terms of the divestment campaigns that were going on in the 80s against South Africa?
Can I firstly say the coming down of the Berlin Wall removed a stumbling block, but it wasn't the main motivation behind what we did. The main motivation behind our new vision of one united South Africa, which was already formulated within the National Party in 1986, was the moral indefensibility of the continuation of the old system. And if I were to put this process of self-analysis, of deep introspection, which brought us to the point to say apartheid is wrong on a scale, and on the other side of the scale, the effect of financial and economic sanctions, then the driving force was inner conviction and not outside pressure. The outside pressure actually at times delayed reform and change in South Africa. We found many ways of circumventing the sanctions. It twisted our economy. It harmed the majority of black South Africans much more than the regime at which it was aimed. It led to an oil from coal process. It led to us building atomic bombs, which it was my privilege to dismantle. It led to us making rubber to replace natural rubber. It twisted our economy. Just give you one figure. At one stage, we had, notwithstanding the oil sanctions, enough oil potted up in old mines and in tanks, plus our oil from coal process, that we could last a total successful blanket of any oil coming into South Africa. We could last for 4 years without getting another drop of new oil. All that money could have been used for more positive things. I'm not a fan of sanctions in the present international climate. It should be reserved for extremely serious cases, and if it doesn't work in 3 or 4 years, it should be acknowledged that sanctions has failed to do the trick. I believe in constructive engagement. I don't know of any dispute or any conflict which has been resolved peacefully unless the parties involved talked to each other, negotiated, made concessions from both sides, and agreed on a workable compromise.
Yes, please. In the center there, in the center.
Thank you. I would like to ask Mr. Orban if what his views on the political radicalization going on right now in the southern and eastern Europe, what your views are on that, and how you see that as a threat to democracy.
That's a good question for the whole night anyway, but may I just approach your question from the point of the title of this conference, that's leadership. So I'm not speaking exclusively on the southern belt of the European Union, but of course, this is the main subject in your question. So we as leaders must confrontate the situation that in the public life in Europe everywhere, mainly in the crisis hit regions. So the public life is full of negative energies. And it's difficult to treat it. The European life, political and public life, is full of with disillusionment, anger, hatred feelings, looking for scapegoats, and so on and so on. So it's negative energy, that's what I call. And the real question is for the leaders how to treat it, especially under the conditions when it's obvious that in the last 5 years in the European Union, we were not successful to treat the economic crisis. What should we say to the people? And taking into consideration that the crisis will not end up next morning, so it will be a period how to get out from that, how we can ask the people to contribute to implement a crisis management economic strategy? Because without involvement of the people, we can't manage the crisis, and we can't have a successful economic strategy. So these kind of challenges, the major one I've ever seen in my political career. You know, when in Hungary, for example, in the middle of the 80s, we organized a society as underground activists anyway, that was under the communist regime, against the Russians, I would like to correct Soviet Union, and against the communists, you know, the negative feeling that we would like to get rid of them was combined with very positive feelings that we would like to get freedom, democracy, to go back to the civilization we always belong to, called Western civilization. So it was a better combination at that time to make radical changes what we just have today. So it's a real challenge. It's the most difficult challenge I've ever seen. Plus, don't forget, it's not PC. But all politicians would like to survive the next elections. So we have to manage to have a successful economic crisis management strategy, to treat the negative feelings of the people, and to win the next election. That's the job. So I think it's a real challenge. So I'm not jealous at all for the job of the European Union Southern Balkan Prime Ministers. So I would like to deal with more with Hungary. It's easier, I think so now. But good luck.
We have a question back there in the blue shirt back there with a hand up now. All right.
Thank you. I would like to ask Mr. Orban, if do you think that European Union benefit much from the ex-communist countries not being inside the Union, as they could have lower wages and cheaper labor that for somehow mm-hmm. benefited our economy?
Mm-hmm. It's living and constant discussions and disputes in the Hungarian politics, and I suppose all over in Central Europe, whether who is the on the winner side by the move joining the European Union. And my answer is very simple. I think it was a good move for the European Union, and regardless of the crisis coming from the Eurozone to those countries like Hungary who are not part of the Eurozone, I still believe that it's far more positive to the impact was far more positive for our nations to join the European Union than not to join. That's I'm still sure about it. But at the same time, you are right. So in Hungary, for example, the average, not the minimum, the average salary per month in a net is 500 euro. And the average pension is approximately 300 per month net. You know, that was not the dream we have had. No question of that. And but on the other side of the coin is, as I try to explain, it was a mistake made by the European Union at the beginning of the 90s, not letting in the ex-communist countries soon to the European Union, because the other side of the coin of low labor cost and relative underdevelopment of the country is that we have a huge potential for economic growth. And I'm sure that if that economic growth potential would have been used, let's say, 14 years earlier, the European economy would not as weak as it is today, but far stronger. So I think it was a mistake. And that's the reason why I'm the great advocate of enlargement of Union towards the European, towards the Balkan region, regardless that in short term it could create some difficulties, but in midterm it's obvious that the European Union will harvest profit from enlarging itself to the Balkan region. So I'm still an advocate on that policy. So it's a little bit sophisticated argument, not the best one now in the simple days we are living in, but I think we still should fight for that argument.
It's fantastic that the youngsters are asking the question. There's a blue shirt there with a, that's it, please stand up.
My question is also for Mr. Orban. What's your problem with homosexuals and homeless people in your country and abroad?
Do we have?
Okay.
Really? The problem with the homeless people that they don't have home. So therefore, the Hungarian constitution is very much clearly stated that it is a compulsory for the state to help them to find a shelter. So I don't like to be too positive on ourselves, but I'm proud about it that in Hungary now you have higher number of public shelters than the number of the homeless people. It's quite rare in Europe. That's first. On homosexuals, I don't understand exactly the question. No, but if you think that it could be an anti-feeling or a negative feeling towards homosexuals, that the Constitution says clearly that marriage is exclusively between one man and one woman, and family means one man and one woman, it's not against anybody, but it's, let's say, it's a 4,000 years tradition, 2,000 years Jewish tradition plus 2,000 years Christian tradition. So to defend something which we have 4,000 years as tradition, I think it's a good move. So it's not against anybody. It's a position to continue our tradition in the future as well. That's all.
Yes, and now in the front here.
My question is for both speakers. Both Mr. de Klerk and Mr. Orban come from countries where constitutional courts played a crucial role in the transition to democracy, and they have spread globally almost to all the democratic world, either with the name constitutional court or with other name. In some of these democracies, lately there have been some clashes or some reactions, political reactions, to constitutional courts. In South Africa, for example, President Zuma recently gave some illustrations on how the powers of the South African constitutional court should be reviewed, I believe, in order to shorten these powers. In Hungary, effective legislative amendments have been recently approved with that purpose. Do you believe that the role of constitutional court as the final interpreter of the constitution in a democracy has perhaps known its days and is perhaps coming to an end? Do you think that this role should be questioned in today's democracies? This question has some a very peculiar importance in Portugal, because I don't know if you're aware of this, but recently there has been a clash between the executive and the judicial branch, the constitutional court, that struck down some legislative measures that were implemented in order to react against the crisis of the sovereign debt. Thank you.
Let me say that I don't think for one moment that the days of constitutional courts are over. I think especially in countries which are highly diverse, as South Africa, we have 11 official languages. Having a constitutional court offers security also specifically to minorities, and I'm not just talking about whites. It offers security to vested interests. The agreement to have a constitutional court and a constitution, that's the important thing, which is the highest law of the land. Parliament, in terms of our constitution, and that constitution is supported by all parties, cannot make a law which is in conflict with the constitution. If it does so, the constitutional court has the power to declare that law passed by Parliament invalid and unconstitutional. And it has happened on more than one occasion. I can understand President Zuma's irritation at times about this, but in the same breath, he and his party has now again at the big annual conference in Mangaung in December restated their absolute commitment to the Constitution, which includes a constitutional court. There is a danger that in society, people might try to misuse a constitutional court. There is a danger that people might try to take issues which are not of a specific constitutional nature nonetheless to the constitutional court. There I put my trust in the constitutional court that it will dismiss such efforts and it will know where to draw the line, what is about constitutionality and what is about politics.
The Hungarian or the Central European experience is very inspiring. Because the collapse of communist regime and the pushing out of the Soviet Union from our territories happened in the form of a constitutional revolution. So therefore, constitutionalism, constitutional court and constitution itself played a very positive role in our transformation. So don't forget that we changed our political system from dictatorship to democracy, and we deliberate our nation without losing even one single human life. That's something. And constitution and constitutional court and all that kind of arrangement played an important role of it. So therefore, in the mind of the Central Europeans, among them the Hungarians, constitutional court always has a privileged place. That's one point. The second point is, I agree with you fully that the Constitutional Court is the interpreter of the Constitution and not the creator.
Yeah.
Because the creator is the people and the elected MPs by the people. So it means that we have to be very clear of sharing of labor. To create the Constitution belonged to the elected member of the parliament under certain procedure, and to interpret the Constitution is the job of the Constitutional Court. Therefore, in Hungary, we don't have at this moment, privileged and rare moment anyway, with the Constitutional Court because we have two-third majority, which means that we were able to create a new Constitution. And if we think that Constitutional Court, which is not the case anyway, but if it would be, not interpreter but creator, we can correct it because we have two-third majority in the parliament, never earlier, so it's a very rare moment. And just in brackets, Hungary was the last country among the post-communist countries who created a new constitution. So we lived from 1990 onwards, during the whole transition period, up to 2011, with a modified communist constitution. We were the only nation who were not able to create a new constitution because of lack of two-third majority for 20 years and no agreement of political elites. So, but after that, in 2010, we got the two-third majority and we created a new constitution. It's a totally new constitution which created a lot of discussions in Europe. One for party reasons, second for ideological reasons, and third for economic reasons. What is more inspiring and appropriate to mention here is the ideological reason, especially because somebody mentioned the homosexuals. So this constitution is absolutely against, on value basis, of the mainstream of European thinking at this moment. The European thinking now can be characterized that they think that there is a so-called progress of European history. And the progress of European history in their minds means, in the mainstream minds, that from Christianity and religious life we're moving to the secular world, from the national feelings we are moving to the international communities, and from the family values we are moving to something mixed up, for individualism or somehow. And our constitution is very much the opposite. We say the state and the church must be separated, but Christianity is the value basis for our life. Absolutely unusual in the beginning of the 21st century in Europe. Second, we say that family is the most important nucleus of the society. We must defend it because this is the future of the nation. And the third, that we are proud that we are a nation and we would like to maintain national identity even if we are a member of the European Union. So ideologically, the constitution we have created is somehow different from the fashionable mainstream approaches to the value questions. That's the reason why, one of the main reasons, why the Hungarian constitution created a European discussion, because this discussion is not about the Hungarian constitution. It's a European discussion. What is the purpose of European history, if it has at all? Can we speak about progress? What is the right of individual nations to create their own set of values? And so on and so on. So I think it's an inspiring, sometimes heated, but basically a positive and inspiring discussion, a European one, on the occasion of the Hungarian Constitution.
The lady in the white there, or with the hand up in the middle sector, or I can't see that far, so it's a young gentleman, I'm sorry.
So I'm Christopher from the Cairo Society. Sorry, I'm a gentleman. I would like to ask Mr. Orban to comment on the role of youth entrepreneurship and job creation in the Hungarian post-communist state. And if possible also, if Mr. de Klerk could comment on the negative impact of affirmative action in post-apartheid South Africa, because The Economist was just writing all about it in the last issue. I would really love that. Thank you.
You first.
No, I'm just writing. Sorry.
Let me start my reply on affirmative action by saying there is a need in South Africa for balanced affirmative action, and there is a need for black economic empowerment. The constitution which we negotiated, in a way, it doesn't use these two words, but it provides for it. It does say, it does draw a distinction between unfair discrimination, and therefore it allows for a concept of fair discrimination. So I support the need for affirmative action and black economic empowerment. But if it is implemented in a way which results in merit being ignored, in merit not being playing an integral part of the evaluation when you appoint somebody, then it leads to, unfortunately, a deterioration in the standards of service. It leads to people being appointed basically just on the basis of race or color to positions for which they don't have sufficient experience or for which they have not been sufficiently trained. And this, unfortunately, has happened to a certain extent in South Africa. This has led to the emigration of substantial numbers of highly trained and well-experienced people. It has led to the loss of a lot of experience. We have a shortage of high-tech, highly trained, well-experienced people, and we have an imbalance in our labor force as a result of that. So I'm all in favor of it, but in South Africa's case, I'm on public record for criticizing the fact that it has been implemented in an unbalanced way, and that has damaged the standards of service. It was not in the interests of the nation of South Africa. I'm not talking about any racial privilege.
Am I right that you have answered about job creation? So
the role of the youth in job creation.
Okay. So the first of all, the best instrument for job creation is low tax. Don't forget about it. Because taxation is perceived by many people that, you know, it's something he has to pay. If he earn more, he has to pay more. Therefore, our concept in Hungary is that we created, it's a European attempt anyway, a different kind of structure for the tax system. So we say, please work more and earn more. You will not pay more tax because it's flat. It's 16% flat tax. And we are happy that you are able to earn more money. That's one thing. The other one, that at the same time, social justice is important, and we have to maintain the public spendings, of course. Therefore, we say that you should pay high VIT taxation, which is one of the highest in Europe anyway. So I think it's better in the future, at least I think it's a future, it's a vision, that in the future it will be better to tax the people when they spend their money and not the moment when they earn the money. So let them earn the money. That's the number one job creation, if I understand correctly, the economy. The second is good education. Good education is very important. But we should not forget about that there is a life outside the universities. Because Europe has a good tradition to create good universities. That's going well. Sometimes we need correction, but this is one of the main reasons for proudness in Europe, good universities. But we must be aware of the anthropological fact that not all the young guy can go to the university. So vocational training and physical training will be part of our life. And I think it's a value, and we must respect the guys who are working physically, not with high education, but ready to do their best efforts to maintain themselves and their families. So therefore, good education does not mean in the future only high-tech university education, but vocational, quality vocational training as well. That's very important in the future. We invested a lot of money and restructuring reforms in Hungary in order to create it. It's not easy at all, but I think that's important. And the third point is probably the small and medium-sized companies. Because it's obvious that the major companies contribute the most to the national GDPs. But at the same time, the highest number of the people are employed by small and medium-sized companies. So therefore, small and medium-sized company support policy by itself is a job creation policy. And finally, the public work. That's a highly debated issue in Hungary, because in Hungary, we have a lot of people who just simply cannot find a job on the market and will not find for several years. Hopefully in the future they will, but not at this moment. And the question is what they should do. And the Hungarian social system was reformed. It's quite brutal. Unemployment 8 period is 3 months. The state organized public work through local governments, agricultural and a lot of other things. And if somebody who is unemployed and rejects to join the public work cannot get any social aid. Plus, if the parents are not ready to send the kids to the school, they can't get any kind of social aid neither. So the Hungarian system is very tough, but I think it's fair. And therefore, last year, we organized more than 200,000 jobs for public works, which is not the solution, of course, because the solution is the market to absorb all the people. But you know, temporarily, you have to do something, especially in the crisis, otherwise the unemployment rate will go up to 20%. In Hungary is now 11 and decreasing. And we will continue to provide more and more public jobs till the moment when the market absorb again the work locations, the labor forces. So there is no miracle. The European economy history already produced all the instruments which can help to produce and to create jobs. We have to select them and put together into a concept. I can't say that Hungary surely will be a successful story by the end of the day. But what I can say that we do something, because many leaders say that, you know, we can't do anything because we have a crisis and the market cannot able to provide more jobs. But it's not a proper answer for a political leader. We have to do something and to make understandable to the people that we are working on that. And sometimes we have to be innovative or unorthodox to find a way to create more and more jobs. So that's how we try to do. Hopefully, the end of the day, we could say that the Hungarian experience and attempt proved to be a successful one, even if it is quite unusual at this moment.
Mr. Moderator, can I? I've been stimulated by what my colleague here has said. I want to say the best form of affirmative action is quality education and quality vocational training and quality universities. That is the best way to empower any individual or any group.
The lady over here. I'm sorry, this lady had put her hand up way before.
Yes, thank you very much for your interesting comments. My name is Elga Barcz. I'm the chief European economist at Morgan Stanley. And I would like to come back to some comments that Viktor Orban made about EU enlargement. If indeed there had been immediate accession for Central and Eastern Europe to the European Union when the Berlin Wall came down, many countries, including Hungary, today would probably find them within the euro. Is this really where you would want to be? And secondly, living in the United Kingdom, I'm starting to get worried that the European Union might potentially shrink in the coming years, as David Cameron seems to be getting under intense domestic political pressure to take a referendum of whether the United Kingdom will stay in the EU or not. So we might for the first time indeed see a large country leaving the EU. And then my question to President de Klerk would be, in the eye of somebody from afar, is that really where Europe becomes marginal because a large country is starting to leave one of the important post-war political institutions in Europe? Thank you very much.
Well, as I understand Mr. Cameron's position, he doesn't want a referendum on the status quo. He wants to negotiate certain restructuring of Europe. And if he succeeds in that, and I get the impression from the media that he's beginning to get support from some other European countries for the need for restructuring, which I also said I'm in favor of. If he succeeds in that, then staying in, a yes to staying in, might in all probability win the referendum in England, and England will stay in. What the British, that's how I read the media, is opposing, I don't have inside information, what makes them irritated is that they are too much prescribed to, they have given away, or the present structure have taken away too much of their sovereignty. And I think Mr. Cameron tries to renegotiate some aspects which will make staying in the European Union is his objective, which will make it easier and will enable him to win such a referendum for a yes vote to stay in.
It's always good to hear somebody who's out of the wood, looking at the wood from that position. My vision, of course, from inside. And I would like to underline here why to be a politician is an entertaining job. And this is the irony of the history. I do remember that in 2006, that was the second election I lost in a row after being prime minister, and then I lost one election and the next one. And I criticized heavily, brutally may I say, that time socialist government that they lost the good heritage they have got from our government, a good economic position, to continue and then join to grab the historical moment to the euro. And I criticized them for that heavily, because they were undisciplined on the budgetary side, you know, a lot of indebtedness and budgetary deficit was created. And then, now we have to admit that probably the irony of the history is that it was far better to have a socialist government who was not able to join the euro than a Fidesz government who would have been to join, able to join. I don't know exactly, because you know it's the past, but you know that kind of irony is part of our life. But anyway, it was not as obvious for me earlier than it is now. Then if you have, if you create or when you create a common currency, in the time when everything is going wild, and the crisis time will come, you can't stop just to have a common currency. You must forward, move forward to create a common fiscal policy and then a common economic policy. You can't avoid that if you have a common currency. That's the life we are living in. That's your problem, I mean. That's a problem in Portugal. And in many countries. So you face now, in the real weight, how important the decision was when you have joined the euro. Because that defined strongly your future, because now it's impossible to move out. You can't devalue your currency because you don't have your own currency. You have to improve your competitiveness, but you don't have monetary policy for that, you know. So the only way for you now to move forward, to have a common fiscal policy, common economic policy, and enjoy the success of the Eurozone, which we don't see at this moment anyway. So that's the problem of the southern countries. But we, who lost the historical moment to join, now got a new chance. Because it's obvious from the Portugal and Spanish lesson that if you join to the Eurozone when you are not developed enough, the distance between the core of the common monetary countries, or currency countries, and the level of your national development is too big, you will suffer later on. So my point is, I try to be not a doctriner, but my point now is that Hungary should not join to the Eurozone still than the Hungarian GDP reach the level at least 90% of the Eurozone countries. It's not for tomorrow program. So that's my point. That's the reason why we are criticized regularly inside the European Union, because we would like to make a clear distinction between the Eurozone countries and non-Eurozone countries. because the economic policy and fiscal policy of any country who belong to the Eurozone can have a direct impact, serious one, on the economic situation of the others. But this is not the case of Hungary. Hungary is not part of the Eurozone. Therefore, our economic policy impact is not as direct at all. It has some impact, but not as direct. So therefore, we, as non-Eurozone countries, deserve and reasonable to get more room for maneuvering to create our own economic policy mixture, which is more streamlined to our nation, national economy, to get out of the crisis. And I'm fighting for that room for maneuvering, which is regularly denied on behalf and limited on behalf of the Commission and on behalf of the European Union. It's very difficult, how to say, dispute. Let's put it in a civilized way. It's a difficult dispute to get more room for maneuvering. And the only chance for me, because you know it's a small country, Hungary, is the success. If I am able, or the country is able, to deliver the economic figures, decreasing indebtedness, lower budget deficit, higher economic growth, good foreign balance trade, and so on and so on, we could be approved. If you are not able to deliver that, we will, you know, just re-educated, may I say, in that way. So I'm fighting for the success as well.
We're running out of time, and there's many questions still to be answered. But if my two speakers agree, we will take a credit on 10 minutes. So I know there's a question over here, but let's go back to the youngsters there. There's so many hands up there, so way back by the translators, because that side hasn't asked. The hand that's up there, I can't see from here.
I'm going to speak in Portuguese because it's more easier for me.
Hold on. What channel is Portuguese?
No, I need English.
Oh, you need English, okay. English. What channel is English? Two?
Second.
Okay. Please.
Muito boa tarde, meu nome é Ana, sou estudante da Universidade de Lusíada de Lisboa e desde já o Centro Político de Relações Internacionais gostaria de agradecer à Câmara Municipal de Cascais por nos dar a oportunidade de poder assistir a estas conferências. A minha pergunta é para o Sr. de Klerk. Em 1960 deu-se um massacre em Shepperfield. 50 anos depois, observámos, alguns meses atrás, novamente, a polícia sul-africana a bater manifestantes mineiros que tentavam lutar pelos seus direitos. A pergunta que eu tenho a fazer é se, após o desaparecimento do presidente Nelson Mandela, não se poderá novamente acordar aquele monstro adormecido que levou à existência do apartheid. Depois gostaria de fazer mais um pequeno comentário. Não nos podemos esquecer que África, sem dúvida nenhuma, é um continente bastante abençoado, quer pela sua riqueza natural, quer pelo povo que nele habita. O nome do hino nacional sul-africano, que espero não me enganar, que é Go Sisikelegi África, que significa Deus abençoe a África. Sem dúvida nenhuma, mais uma vez repito, a África é bastante abençoada. O que acontece muitas vezes é que é liderado por pessoas que não respeitam os direitos daqueles que lá habitam.
Come to your question, please.
Okay.
Because we can't go on, we have to cut the question short. Please come to your question.
The question, as I understand it, is what will happen when, and we all hope it won't happen soon, when President Mandela dies? Will there be a, will we fall back into racial conflict and the like? Let me first say about apartheid. Apartheid has been removed. Apartheid has been written out of our legal system. Apartheid is dead. Apartheid will not revive in South Africa. I believe the biggest legacy of Nelson Mandela was his commitment to reconciliation, to the concept which he always stood for, that all the people in South Africa, black, white, colored, Indian, should all be citizens, first-class citizens with the same rights, and that we should put the bitterness of the past behind us, not forget it, but we should not allow it to be carried into the future, that we should reconcile. And I firmly believe that when he dies, that legacy will again be the center of bringing the whole South African nation together and taking hands in mourning one of the greatest South Africans who ever lived.
There's a question over there. Would you please stand up?
Good afternoon. My question is for Prime Minister Viktor Orban. Mr. Prime Minister, I wonder if you could comment on the rise of the far right and the extremist movements against minority populations, specifically anti-Roma and anti-Semitic sentiments gaining ground in Hungary. What initiatives are being taken to combat this kind of xenophobia and prejudice? Thank you very much.
I know only one policy which can be effective in that ground, and this is zero tolerance. The Hungarian constitution, which is a newly created one, as I have mentioned, is very clear on that. At the center of our constitution and legal system is human dignity. What is against human dignity cannot be tolerated, so it's zero tolerance. But there is one point in the Hungarian constitution which you cannot find in any other constitution of the European nation. So it's a real innovation. We will see how does it work in the future anyway, but I think it's a great attempt. Because human dignity is perceived everywhere in Europe as an individual right. The Hungarian constitution declare and guarantees of that. But we went one step forward. We say that there's a human dignity of the communities. So if we belong to a community, and this community is attacked, you know, not only physically, but, you know, insulted in any way, you, as a person belonging to that community, because of the human dignity of your community, you can get a legal answer to that, and you can go to the court to get back your human dignity in many, many ways, like civic way and penalty, civic law and penalty law as well. So I think that kind of defense of human dignity of the communities, it's an innovation and it's a good one. Back to the first point you have made. So we have to live with your society, all of us. So if you look back the Hungarian history, you constantly find that at the elections, regularly, extremists, sometimes left, sometimes right, got approximately 16-17%. That's happened in the 1920s, 30s, and even in the 40s. The same structure we have. So we have a radical political party in the parliament, which is rather sometimes extremist and not only radical, 17%. But this is a constant element of the Hungarian society. The question is, which is the best way to treat it? And our answer is zero tolerance first. And second, we need a strong, center-right, Christian-based civic party, which is pro-merit society, which is pro-competition, pro-freedom, pro-private ownership, and so on and so on. If we are strong enough and we are successful, there is no political room for the extremist from the right side. So the best way is to be stronger, stronger, and stronger. If you would have been a Hungarian, I would say the only way to fight against the extremists, vote for us. But you are not a Hungarian, so therefore it has no sense to say that. But this is the only way, as I understand.
One more question from the youngsters, the future. I let the people who manage the microphones choose.
Okay, so my name is Eduardo. I'm from Skolsels in Munich. My question is for Mr. Viktor Orban. In your, you said that Europe needs strong political leaders. That being said, we Portuguese are being called a good student because our politics accept Europe's instructions and help without complaining. The Spanish took a different approach and protested. If hypothetically, in Hungary, you undertook the same situation, what would you do? Would you take the Portuguese approach or the Spanish one? Thank you.
What is the difference? Can I have clarity about what's the difference of the two approaches? Yes.
First of all, I'm basically a freedom fighter. So I'm not a carrier type politician. That's a background for my answer. So you know, I'm a village boy from a plebeian background. And I have never thought that any time I will be involved into politics. It's happened in the 80s under the communist regime to the underground student politics. I was involved into that. And somehow I realized that it's a real challenge. Sometimes I realize that I have something animal inside myself, a political animal. That's a very important thing, to enjoy your job and do the job. And plus, history was very much challenging from the 80s up to now. So I think it's a real inspiring job to be done, or a mission, may I say, in that way. So I stayed in politics. So from that background, you will probably understand my answer. So be a freedom fighter. It's still relevant. I personally established a political party, a political movement in 88 under the communist regime, which just exclusively was for young generation. There was an age limit, 35. Nobody who was over 35 could join the party. Later we changed because we get older, but anyway, that's another story. But my point is that each generation should define their life targets personally, a community, and the nation as well. So stand up and fight for your own vision and for your own Europe. Nobody will create that instead of you, whatever Portugal or Spanish answer to certain. If you would like to be a real great generation, you have to find your own freedom-based answer to what's going on in Brussels and to the European Union. That whatever is a Spanish or a Portuguese kind of answer is that. So be yourself, a new generation, and fight for own vision. That's the only answer I can give to you.
Mr. President.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not au fait with the differences between the Portuguese approach and the Spanish approach. Maybe I see we're over time.
Yes.
Let me end my contribution by saying what I regard as a good leader. There are many things one could add, but a good leader needs to have a vision. And a good leader then tries to get in a democracy, the voters to embrace that vision, to take co-ownership for it. He does not look at the polls and define the vision according to what the best result will be. A good leader has a goal, a clearly defined vision, and try to convince others to adopt that vision. Make your choice in applying this definition as to which of the country's alternative is the best.
On these two fantastic comments, I would like to thank both of you for the fantastic session. I'd like to thank the audience for the good questions that they put, and now Clara has to tell us what we're supposed to do.
Well, first of all, on behalf of the President Carlos Carreiras, I'd like to invite Viktor Orban and Frederic de Klerk to join us in the closing session, if you please. But you can return, they will indicate you where you can sit.